Friends, good morning.
Good morning.
And happy Easter to you. It is great to see you. Everybody looks so nice today, all dressed up. Got your Easter finest on. Someone mentioned that I am actually wearing a tie today. There's a reason I haven't been wearing a tie. During COVID, my shirt's all shrunk, and I couldn't button my top button. But today, I was able to button the top button. Anyway, it's great to see you, and happy Easter to you. You'll see that during the service, we have a little different order than we typically do, and so just follow along. We'll begin our service with scripture and hymns and singing, and then we'll kind of get back into our normal flow. But again, on behalf of this church, I want to welcome all of you who might be visiting today. My name is Sean Barkley. I'm the teaching elder here at Crestview, and it's just my pleasure to welcome you. If you are here today and you think, you know, I'd like to learn more about this church, please feel free to reach out to me. I'd love to have a conversation with you about all that's going on here at Crestview. Of course, you can see our TV monitors out in the hallways and learn a little bit about the church and our schedule. After worship today, we'll have some coffee in our narthex and gathering grounds area, and we invite you to stay for that. We also have an online e-newsletter. We call it Beyond the Bulletin, and so if you would like to receive that, you can go to our church website and sign up. It's just a way for us to all stay in touch with one another. So again, welcome and happy Easter to each of you. We always begin our worship with prayer, and our method here at Crestview is to pray Scripture, and so I'll read Scripture and give you time to meditate on it, and then we'll pray that Scripture back to God. So let's all take a deep breath. Relax and bow our heads and enter into a time of prayer. This morning we're praying Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Our gracious God, hear us as we read your word back to you. Now to God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. Now to God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or even imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. Our gracious God, as we bow together on this Easter morning, our hearts are overflowing with gratitude and joy for the good news that he is risen indeed. And Lord, we know that because of the resurrection, you can do more in our lives than we can ask or even imagine. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that is working within us right now. And we pray, Lord God, that as we worship you, we'll feel you drawing near to us. We pray that you encourage us, enlighten us, and also we pray that everything we do today will bless and glorify your holy name. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The women went to the tomb early Sunday morning to anoint the body. When they got there, they found that the stone had been rolled away. They went inside. Suddenly, two angels appeared and asked, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He isn't here, but he is risen." They weren't seeking the living. They were seeking a corpse. They hadn't come to say hello. They came to make sure that Jesus got a proper burial. The question isn't properly addressed to them, but to us. Why do we seek the living among the dead? Jesus is the Lord of life and of hope for life eternal. He told his disciples, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will still live, even if he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die."
Oh. But Mary stood outside the tomb, weeping. As she wept, she knelt to look into the tomb and saw two angels sitting there, dressed in white, one at the head, the other at the foot of where Jesus' body had been laid. They said to her, "Woman, why do you weep?" "They took my master," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." After she said this, she turned away and saw Jesus standing there. But she didn't recognize him. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why do you weep? Who are you looking for?" She, thinking he was the gardener, said, "Sir, if you took him, tell me where you put him so I can care for him." Jesus said, "Mary." Turning to face him, she said in Hebrew, "Rabboni, my teacher."
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross.
No one good. love so sure, nothing it can't endure. There is a life it brings that's greater than anything. I once was dead within, hallowed by all my sin, lost and so led astray, but your love reached all the way. Your love reached all the way. All the wondrous cross where the Prince of Glory died. All the glorious cross where your mercy bled for us. You overcame the grave, went into a world you saved. Oh, the wondrous cross.
Philippians 2, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, in heaven and on earth, under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's sing this scripture.
like to invite you to stand now with me as we make our Easter proclamation. We'll read responsively. You'll find it on the screen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Death has been swallowed in victory.
The grave has lost its sting.
Christ is risen. Fridays ago, I was visiting one of our church members in the hospital, and on the TV was a space launch. Did you see that two Fridays ago? Interesting, SpaceX, the company founded and CEO'd by a man named Elon Musk, there was a space launch. It was the first private manned space launch to the International Space Station. So it was a big deal. And my friend and I, we watched this with great interest. And as I was watching, I was thinking, who is Elon Musk? And I started wondering about that, so I decided to do a little bit of research about him. Of course, he's one of the wealthiest people in the world, net worth of over $300 billion with a B dollars. Elon Musk is adventurous. In fact, years ago, Elon Musk looked at Mars and thought, I wonder what it would be like to colonize that planet. Can you imagine? I mean, what do we know about Mars? It's the red planet. It's next door to Earth. It's on the other side from the sun, right? It's colder there than it is here. But can you imagine looking at that and thinking, you know, I wonder what it'd be like to live there. And so I thought, I'm going to learn a little bit more about this man. And I found something very interesting about his past. In 1950, his grandparents were living in Canada. And they decided, we're going to move to South Africa. So they just picked up and moved. And while they were in Canada, his grandfather bought a 1948 Balonica Cruise Airlines airplane. He disassembled the airplane, packed it in crates, and shipped it all the way to South Africa. Whenever the crates arrived in South Africa, Musk's grandfather reassembled the 1948 Balonica Cruise airplane, and then he and his wife flew that airplane from South Africa to Australia and back, nearly 30,000 miles. They were the first private pilots to make that trip. As I read that story, here's what occurred to me. Elon Musk was not living during that time, but I guarantee you he heard those stories. And those stories about his grandparents, I believe, shaped who he is. So that now, when he thinks about what he'd like to do, he doesn't see limitations because he remembers my grandparents disassembled an airplane, reassembled it, and flew all the way to Australia from South Africa. That story has created a narrative for who he is as a person. And the truth is, the stories that you and I hear about ourselves, the experiences that we have in life, those things create a narrative for who we are. I remember when my son was a teenager, I bought a book called Storyline, or titled Storyline, by a man named Donald Miller. And in the book, he talked about the importance of teaching our children about who they are and helping them project into the future as to who they someday might be. And so I'm sure that when my son was a teenager, he probably thought, why does my dad talk so much about the future? But the reason I did was I was trying to project for him a narrative. This is who you are. This is who you can be. This is what God can do with your life. As we are gathered here on this Easter Sunday, I want to suggest that the narrative that you and I have been hearing about this morning, about an empty tomb and a resurrection, can be our storyline. It can literally change the way that you and I live. Change the way we think about ourselves, and change the way we think about others, and change the way we think about this world around us. I know on Easter Sunday, I'm aware because I hear on social media from folks that there are people who might be here right now or who are worshiping with us online. We have hundreds of people who do that every week, for whom this story makes no sense. For whom this story just is almost like a fantasy or a fairy tale. And if you fall into that category, let me just tell you that you're not the first one to think that. In fact, Luke 24, verse 11, check this out. After the women had come back and reported that the tomb was empty, these are the disciples who were walking with Jesus Christ every day for 3 years. They did not believe the women. Why? Because the words seemed like nonsense. You see, just because this thing happened 2,000 years ago doesn't mean those people were primitive. I mean, y'all, they knew that dead people are dead. They knew that death was it. They, unlike you and me, had probably seen dead bodies in their houses before, and they knew those dead bodies, they did not move. And so, after the crucifixion, Nicodemus, a friend of Jesus's, and Joseph of Arimathea had taken that body to the tomb. It belonged to Joseph, and they had kind of hastily anointed it with spices just to get it ready. And then here's what happened on that first Easter morning, verse 1 of chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and they went to the tomb. You see, they took spices. Why? Because they were going to anoint his body. They were not anticipating a resurrection. In fact, one gospel writer says, as they were walking, they were saying, who's going to roll away the stone for us? And so, in their mind, it was over. Jesus was dead. They were going to anoint his body and just get on with their lives. And that's what they were planning on doing. I want to just step back for a moment here and just say this. It's significant that God chose the women to be the first witnesses to share testimony of the resurrection. You see, in first century Palestine, women were not even permitted to give testimony in court. Their testimony was not even accepted. And so God chose these women who could not give testimony in court to be the very first ones to give testimony. You know, let's just think about it kind of logically. If Luke were trying to write something that didn't happen, if he were trying to tell some kind of fairy tale, he would have never said the very first people to see the risen Christ were women. But again, it reinforces the truth. And so after the women have come back, they've talked to the disciples. The disciples think, hey, this is nonsense. Here's what happens in verse 12. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. You know Peter, he's always impulsive. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away amazed, wondering to himself what happened. This morning, I just want to think with you about what is amazing about the resurrection, and why does it matter to you? And why does it matter to me? Why does it matter? I mean, what's the purpose of all this? And so I've got just a couple or three quick thoughts. The first thing that the resurrection teaches us, the first thing in my mind that is amazing about the resurrection, is that it confirms that God has redeemed us. God has accepted the payment Jesus made for our sins on the cross. You see, all the way back in Genesis chapter 3, we learn that the curse of sin is death. That when humans are separated from God, the penalty or the punishment is death. But the resurrection confirms that Jesus has paid that price. You know, we are all folks who are sinful people. My sins don't look like yours, yours don't look like me. In fact, I was reading recently an article about the most sinful states in America. Not state of being, states like, you know, Kentucky and Ohio. And so anyway, this is a 2022 poll. Guess where Ohio rates among the most sinful states in America? All right, so here's the metric. They took the seven deadly sins, and they evaluated every state according to the seven deadly sins. So Ohio, we're number 19, right smack dab in the middle. We were number 20 before my wife moved here, but that's okay. Kind of slid down one there. But here's what I thought was really interesting, y'all. In terms of excesses and vices, Ohio is number 2 in the country. Excesses and vices. I think a lot of that has to do with what happens in Columbus on Saturdays during football season. I'll tell you right now. But we're all sinful. Just for fun, just for kicks, what do you think the most sinful state is? Nevada. That's exactly right. And this is a tough one, though. What is the least sinful state? What would you think? Utah's a good guess. Idaho. Idaho is the least sinful. I don't know. But the truth is, that's our human condition. We are all sinful, and we are separated from God because of our brokenness. In that Old Testament system of sacrifice to atone for sin, that was imperfect. That did not ultimately redeem humanity. Now the ultimate sacrifice has been made. Y'all, the resurrection of Jesus Christ verifies this. So I think about it in these terms. Yesterday, I went to Costco. I saw you there. And so I was at Costco yesterday. Have you ever been there? You know, whenever you leave Costco, they don't trust you. And so you got to walk out with your stuff, and you got your arms full like this, and then you've got to do what with the receipt? You've got to give it to the lady standing there, right? And she counts everything, and then she makes sure, and then she checks it off. She verifies that you've paid for what you've got. When I think about the resurrection, what does that have to do with you and me? Why does it matter? It is the way that God has verified our sins have been paid for. and we've been redeemed. Another thought. The resurrection is amazing to me because we can experience God's power to transform our lives because of what has happened here. You see, not only did our original sin separate us from God, it created a deep brokenness within us. And let's be honest with each other. As we're sitting in this room right now, we all experience a deep brokenness in one way or another. And again, my brokenness doesn't look like yours. Yours doesn't look like the brokenness of the person seated next to you. But what has happened now is that God has given us the power to start overcoming our sins. Slowly and over time, God's making us new. I mean, one of the women who went to the tomb was Mary Magdalene. And you would think Mary Magdalene, she's one of the first people to see the risen Christ, would have been perfect. You know, the New Testament says that Jesus cast 7 demons out of her life. And 7 is the biblical number for completeness. She was completely possessed. She was deranged. She had moral failures. She had all kinds of mental issues. And Jesus literally changed her and made her new. That's what the resurrection does for you and me. God begins to make us new. I love what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old one is gone, and the new one has come. This gives you and me hope that these flawed and broken lives can be made new. You know, I was meditating this week, actually Friday, about the crucifixion. And I was pondering, why do you think that God waited 3 days to raise him from the dead? Because he could have done it like that, right? Why did he wait 3 days? Of course, it was prophesied. But one of the things that occurred to me was that in that gap of time, the disciples were left to contemplate. And that there was a passage of time, just like you and I have a passage of time in our lives where, you know, we want things to be perfect, but they're not yet perfect. And I just think there's something symbolic about the fact that God just waited. You see, God is at work in your life right now. And it might not feel like you're making any progress. And it might not feel like you're getting anywhere right now. But remember, it was Friday, and now it's Sunday. And in your life, if it feels like Friday right now, have hope, because Sunday's on the way. And then one more thing. What is so amazing about the resurrection? Why does it matter to you and me? And this is my favorite one. 1 Corinthians 15. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will be true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. It's amazing that the resurrection means we have assurance that the curse of death, dating all the way back to Genesis 3, has been removed. These bodies are going to die, but you're not going to, and I'm not going to either. I mean, just as those first century people, they understood that death is death, and we get that too, we also understand that because of the resurrection, we're going to live forever with God. I mean, what an amazing blessing. You know, we all know that death is inevitable. I mean, these bodies, they are slowly perishing. And the older we get, the more we know it. But we live with assurance. Some of you might not know, but we have a memorial garden here. And it's beautiful. In fact, it's beautiful right now. And in the spring, it gets even more and more beautiful. It's right back, where am I right now? There. In the southwest. Thank you for the help, by the way. In the southwest corner. Here's what's amazing about our memorial garden. So we have all these people whose ashes are buried there. And there are these large stones with those who are buried there named. Their name, their date of birth, and their date of death. There are also on those memorial stones people's names who are sitting here right now. And only one date is on there. But everyone who's sitting here right now whose name is on there knows that someday the second date will be on there as well. And that's true for all of us. And so the resurrection to me is such a potent reminder that there will be a day coming when God will welcome us into his eternal presence. And that's what it's all about. These bodies are going to die, but we're not. And so all the struggles and all the failures and all the sadness, it's all going to be wiped away. And we're going to be restored to our Creator forever. I mean, hallelujah. One final passage. And I just want to unpack this quickly with you. Again, 1 Corinthians 15. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits. We're going to get back to that. What does that mean, the first fruits? The first fruits of all those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through the one man, Adam, right? The resurrection from the dead comes through the one man, Jesus Christ. What does it mean that His resurrection is the first fruits of the dead? What do you do with that? Well, let's think about agriculture. We know that the first fruits of a crop, that is an example of what the rest of the crop's going to be, right? So if you go to an apple tree and there's only one apple on the tree, you pluck that apple off, you know that the next thing you're going to pluck off will be another apple. It's not going to be a French fry on that apple tree, right? Jesus' resurrection is an example of what He's going to do for you and me. And so that's the amazing thing of the gospel. We can look at the resurrection and we can see our future. And so, yeah, I was thinking again about our storyline in our narrative. What would your storyline look like if you had the full assurance of these promises? That our lives have been redeemed, that our sins have been forgiven, that we have the power of God within us to begin conquering and overcoming the things that are going to slow us down and weigh us down and keep us from being the people God wants us to be. And also, what would it be like to live with the assurance that when this life is over, and there are two dates on those markers back there, that we will be eternally living with God? That's why we gather on a day like this, to celebrate that good news. I'd like to invite you to pray with me now. And as we do, let's just lift up our prayers of praise. Eternal God, again, we thank You for this day, and we thank You for the remarkable good news that in Your Son we have been redeemed. We thank You for the remarkable good news that by the power of Your Spirit within us, we can begin to become more and more like Jesus Christ. And we thank You for the good news that when our days here are ended, we have a house with You, a building that is not made with human hands, that is eternal in heaven. We thank You, God, that You're going to wipe away every tear from our eyes, and death will be no more. There'll be no more crying, nor mourning, nor pain, for all these things are going to be gone. And so as we continue on this Easter day, we pray that You give us this full assurance, fill us with joy and hope. We lift all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
thanks to each of you for making this just a beautiful worship service. And thanks to you, too. You done good. I've been working with him for 5 years now, trying to get him. Oh, friends, go in peace. Go in the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit. May the Lord be with you today and forever. Amen.